Glory be to the Lord's holy name. As I told you earlier this morning, I'm continuing the meditation what we had last week, escape from and escape to. Escape, run for your life. But this morning I'm going to share only one point for two reasons. Reason number one, I don't think the time will be sufficient for me to dwell more points. Number two, I don't want any other point to overshadow this important point. Just only one point, I want that to make an indelible print in your hearts. And with that, I want you to go back to your homes. If you got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to Genesis chapter 19. We shall read verses 16, 17 and 18. Genesis chapter 19. And while Lot lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand, the angels of the Lord, laid hold upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him. And they, the angels, brought him forth, and set him without the city. And it came to pass, when they had brought them forth abroad, that he said, the angel said, escape for thy life, look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all the plain. Escape to the mountain, escape from Sodom, escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed, that he may not be destroyed. That he may not be consumed. And Lot said unto them, and Lot replied them, who are not so, my Lord. Who are not so, my Lord. Lot was a righteous man. If you read the Bible carefully, the Bible calls seven biblical characters the just man, righteous man. One of the seven righteous men in the Bible, Lot was a righteous man. But the end of Lot was painful, sorrowful, and certainly a lesson for all. A brother was telling me last week, nobody names their child Lot. He was a righteous man. But nobody names their child a Lot. It's something that we have to think. This righteous man made many fatal mistakes. I remember many years back when I was in ACA, the seven steps for the failure of Lot, which gave way for the birth of Moab and Ammon. Seven steps for the fall of Lot. My dear brother, my dear sister, here we see a beautiful scene between Sodom and the mountain the Lord has chosen for Lot. Between Sodom, what Lot has chosen, and the mountain, what God has chosen, Lot was lingering. Lot was lingering, indecisive, between Sodom, that was the choice of Lot, and the mountain, that was the choice of God. In between, Lot was lingering, and his end was painful. Though he decided, go to the mountain, God has chosen. Finally, he went to the mountain, God has chosen. Nevertheless, the end was painful, sorrowful, and a lesson for all. So certain things when the scriptures say, run from that, escape from that, save yourself from that. You have to run from that. And in all the places when the Bible says, run from that, the Bible says, where you should run to. escape from and escape to. Escape from and escape to. Last week we saw 3 points. I don't want to take time to dwell on it. One is, save yourself from untoward generation. When we say untoward generation, they are not sinners. They are not evil people. They are untoward to you. They are different from you. Their idea of salvation is different. Their idea of baptism is different. Their idea of Holy Spirit is different. Their idea about holiness is different. Their concept on the truth is different. Their concept on the ministry is different. A few days back, I received an invitation. There is a type of a pattimandra. Ooliyam, Alaipa, Pilaipa. This is a beautiful topic. Ooliyam, Alaipa, Pilaipa. So there are different types of teachings. There are different types of teachings on grace. What you learn here about grace may be different about what people learn about grace. So anything that is untoward about your holiness, about worldliness, about the fashions of the world, about the spirit of the world. So when somebody brings a different message, a different gospel, a different concept of truth, other than what you learned in the church, what you learned from the Bible, flee from them. Don't receive them to your house. Don't sit and talk with them. You will be losing your salvation. You will be losing your salvation. Join with the saints God has given you. Grow in the Bible teaching what you receive in the church God has planted you. Everything test and see. Everything test and see. My dear brother, my dear sister, to be very brief, not dwelling on what we studied last week. Number one, save yourself from the untoward generation. Number two, flee from fornication. Any sexual immorality in any form. And I gave you last week the definition about fornication and all. I don't want to get into detail. It's sex relationship, any form outside lawful monogamous marriage between a man and a woman is basically sin. Anything outside a marital relationship, that's also through monogamy, one man, one woman. Whether it's a thought, or it's just a hug, or it's a kiss, or lying together, whatever it may be, you can't say, I just only had a thought. In what level you can draw the line? We are not lying together. A hug, a kiss, caressing, writing a letter, smiling. What level you can draw the line? Be careful, according to the Bible, whatever the world may say. Whatever the world may say. In one of the European countries, the church has solemnized marriage between a mother and a son. A lawful marriage. So I'm not questioning about the world. I'm not questioning about the churches in the world. And what the Bible says. What the Bible says. Even the world may call a premarital sex or a postmarital sex punidam. A sex outside marriage. Where before marriage or after marriage. In any form. According to the Bible, it is fornication. The word for fornication is a Greek word, is pornia. From that only we get the word pornography, porn movies, porn, etc. Pornia means unlawful lust. Unlawful lust. A few days back, a young man came to meet me. He said he has got love problem. I said, I don't have love problem. My love is Very smooth and very perfect. No problem in my love. I am in love with a woman. He looked at me. I said, we are in love for nearly 40 years. We started loving one another after marriage and our love is growing. Our love is growing. We are excited about our love. My dear brother, my dear sister, love starts after marriage. I was talking with that young man a few days back. It's almost nonsensical. It's an arrow of Cupid. Probably, I don't know whether the word stupid is drawn from that. So I don't know whether it's the arrow of Cupid or the arrow of stupid. Certainly, it's an arrow of an evil spirit. People fall in love. And when they disobey their parents, the raven of the river, the evil spirits, pluck their eyes. They are unable to see what is the truth. Then they say love is blind. Number three, last week we considered flee from idolatry. Flee from idolatry. Idolatry, two things. Number one, Christian idols. Children, flee from idols. Flee from idols. Having a sign of cross, it's an idol. Or the picture of Jesus, picture of Mary, or a doll, or some saints. Any form of idol, the Bible doesn't agree. Three things. You should not make idols. You should not keep idols. You should not worship idols. Somebody may say, I don't worship idols. But the Bible is very clear. You should not keep idols. You should not make idols. And for somebody, spear is an idol. For somebody, trishul is an idol. And for many Christians, cross is an idol. Neither Jesus was keeping cross as an idol, nor the apostles were carrying a cross as an idol. It was a weapon of murder. Just imagine, Kotche killed our father of nation, Mahatma Gandhiji, with a pistol. And tomorrow the government declares pistol the emblem of India. How rubbish it would be. The Romans killed Jesus on the cross. Romans killed Jesus on the cross. And we say the cross is the emblem of the church. It's a worship symbol. It's a symbol of oath. In the Thali they'll have a cross. Why? You think that's the binding factor? That's weapon of murder? A cruel weapon of murder? My dear brother, my dear sister, any form. Yesterday just I was going through the web, internet, and in one site I was able to see 5,000 tree. I don't know why it's so fractional. 5,003. 5,003 different images of Jesus Christ. Which image is right? Which image is right? And Jesus Christ was a Jewish man. He is from the land of Judah. And most of these pictures, Jesus would look like an European. Funny, horrible. My dear brother, my dear sister, if you can't say, I don't worship idols, I just keep idols as a sign. I don't see anywhere in the Bible. Bible permits you to keep an idol as a sign. Some years back, a man from TPM, who is very proud of TPM, he strongly believed that TPM alone would be raptured. When he was taking his papers from out, there was a small card fell down. That card has got a cross embedded. And it was written in that cross, if you carry this cross when you drive a scooter or car, God will protect you from accident. Nonsense, rubbish. I asked him, you say that you are from TPM. Do you believe this card can protect you? No, the Bible says don't keep. Don't keep. You not only make, not only worship, don't keep. You have to flee from idols. Children, Flee from idols. John says, my children, flee from idols. Flee from idols. Many years back when we were in Annanagar, I remember I preached a sermon, no to Christian idols. No to Christian idols. My dear brother, my dear sister, number two about Christian idols. Number two is about Christian idols. The covetousness, materialism, that is an idolatry, the Bible says. Lust for bike, lust for computer, lust for phone, lust for a smartphone, lust for the worldly things, making those things idol, thinking that you cannot live without that bike, you cannot live without that car, you cannot live without that refrigerator, you cannot live without that iPad, you cannot live without that computer. That's again nonsensical. You should flee from that. Number three, last week I didn't tell you, it's very, very important. Certain toys, certain souvenirs, that can become an idol. I just touch that and go. God willing, I'll speak about it later on a special message. Certain toys, that Barbie doll and that teddy bear. Like that, there are certain things infested with curses. Barbie doll was invented by a witch. Barbie doll is not for the children to play with. In Barbie doll, always you see a young girl, her parts of body exaggerated. A very narrow hip, big breast, big back, her body exaggerated. And you can change the dress, you can play with the dolls. And the very purpose of inventing the doll, for people to touch the parts, hear the parts of a body when they change the dress and all. Sometime back they bought a Barbie doll pregnant. So you can just remove the abdomen and see the baby doll within, baby Barbie within. The very purpose was evil. And I was preaching about that. When evangelist after the service came to me and said, Pastor, I never thought about it. But wherever I go, if I see a Barbie doll, somehow I give a second look to it. Only today I knew what evil in it. So I don't want to take time on it. I can go on and on and on. Probably I may not be able to get into the next point today. But you have to be careful about even the dolls we are using. And because this illustration is coming very strong in my mind, very briefly I say this, and I don't know whether I told you last week or not. There was a preacher went to Japan, an American preacher went to Japan. So he had wonderful crusades. When he came back from Japan, his relationship with his wife was not very cordial. There were some problems. He was suffering from fantasy sex. Though he had sex with his wife, he was imagining other women. He was imagining other women when he had sex with his wife. And he was a very sincere servant of God. His heart was very painful that he was not sincere to his wife. Then he thought, at least I must confess my sin to my wife. Then I could have deliverance. He confessed his sin to his wife. She started weeping. She said, darling, I don't know. I am also suffering from the same problem. Whenever I got sex with you, I imagined somebody else. Today the Lord is going to give us deliverance. They held their hands together. They prayed. Nevertheless, subsequently, they could not have deliverance. Their sex life was dwindling. After some time, I believe another servant of God from Japan came to America to visit this missionary. So in their bedroom, they are sitting and talking. When this American was in Japan, they gave him that Japanese fan as a souvenir, a big wall hanging, a Japanese fan as a souvenir, just close to his bed. This American missionary had that Japanese fan. When the Japanese man saw that souvenir, he said, "Pastor, why you got this here?" He said, "Why, they gave me in America. What's Japan? What's wrong in it?" "Oh, that is the goddess of prostitution. The Japanese goddess of prostitution." Throw the Japanese fan away. He never thought it was a goddess. He thought some picture, some traditional picture. Immediately, it was too instant. They took that fan and threw it away. From that day again, they found deliverance. God willing, I take this topic separately because this miracle has taken place like this in my ministry. When I was ministering at Mayiladuthurai some years back, God willing, we'll have that topic about Christian idols later. But remember, number one, literally Christian idols like pictures, cross, etc., crucifix, some Madonna, throw it away. Number two, covetousness. Number three, very careful about toys and souvenirs and some material that you use. We have to flee from those things. Today I am going to take a very important topic. The fourth point, flee from vain babblings. Flee from vain babblings. Chatterboxes. But some people talking. When they come into the church, they'll talk. They talk to the left, talk to the right, they turn back and talk. After the service is over, they stand talk. And they go home, talk. We have to be very, very careful about it. I'm going to show you a few verses from the Bible for your own blessing that you should not be consumed. Just I'm going to read these Bible passages. Then I'll be sharing with you 20 points. Only 20 points in the fourth point. 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 7. 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 7. "But refuse profane and old wives' fables." Refuse profane and old wives' fables. "And exercise thyself rather unto godliness." Escape from and escape to. From vain babblings to godliness. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 16. "But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness." If you have these vain babblings and profane talks, you will increase in ungodliness. More and more you talk vain things, more and more you would become ungodly. More and more you just talk, chat, more and more you'll grow ungodly, the Bible says. 2 Timothy 2:23. "But foolish and unlearned questions or arguments avoid." That refuse, then shun, hear the word avoid, "knowing that they do gender strifes." More and more sit and talk, it will generate quarrel. It will generate strifes. The Bible says, "Foolish and unlearned questions avoid. They gender, or they generate, or they give birth." The literal meaning, they give birth strifes. 1 Timothy 6:20. All from Epistle to Timothy now. 1 Timothy 6:20. "What, Timothy? Keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of signs falsely so called." It seemed to be very smart when you talk. Avoid those type of foolish talks. It seems to be very science, omniscient, very intelligent, knowledgeable. All nonsense. Titus 3:9. "But avoid foolish questions and genealogies." More about in the world, in a jadi, உங்க அப்பா யாரு உங்க அம்மா யாரு Okay, have an idea, it's okay. Getting into all those type of details, it's not understanding the genealogy of somebody. No, not that. What gene? What community? This type of unnecessary genealogies. Avoid them. That could contentions and strivings about the law, for they are unprofitable and vain. They are unprofitable and vain. 1 Peter 3:10. For he that will love life, if you love life, and seek good days, you want to have good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil. Shun, refuse, avoid. Here we read the word refrain your tongue from evil, and his lips, that they speak no guile, from evil and guile. Ephesians 4:29. Let no corrupt communication. In Tamil we read Ketavartha. Let no Ketavartha proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Only good word, nalla vartha, that will minister grace to the hearers, not ketta vartha. Ephesians 5. Are you making note of it? Ephesians 5, from verse 3 to 5. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you, as becometh of saints. You are saints. You can't be in fornication, uncleanness. You are saints. You can't go behind covetousness. I don't know to how many pastors it could be applicable. They're going behind covetousness. Even the name. I cannot do ministry without cycle. I cannot do ministry without car. I cannot do ministry without discomfort. It's absolute nonsense. My dear brother, my dear sister, that even the name should not be once mentioned, because we are saints. And verse 4, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient. In Tamil, appadiye. You should not have fornication. You should not have uncleanness. You should not have covetousness. Likewise, you should not have filthy talk. You should not have foolish talk. You should not have jesting, just ordinary jokes, which are not proper, but rather giving of thanks. For that you know that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, not covetous man who is an idolater, had any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. So it's not only adultery, it's not only fornication, it's not only murder. Likewise, you should not have foolish, vain, jesting talks. We have to be very careful even about jestling. We have to be very careful about jestling. Okay, vain talk, foolish talk, jestling, all those things we understand. Even when you sit in the house, you, your husband and wife, parents and children, what you talk, you have to be very careful. If you have got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to Deuteronomy chapter 1. I love that everybody will make a note of it and turn to Deuteronomy chapter 1. Deuteronomy chapter 1. Please open to go to Deuteronomy chapter 1. I read from verse 25 and throw some light on that passage. And they took of the fruit of the land from Canaan. the spies Moses sent. They took of the fruit of the land in their hands and brought it down unto us, unto the Israelites who were in the camp, and brought us word again. The spies brought the word again and said, it's a good land. They all said openly, it's a good land which the Lord our God doth give us. It's a good land the Lord would give us. That's what they said. Not only Joshua and Moses. Please listen. Not only Joshua and Moses. Openly everybody said, it's a good land. The Lord would give us the land. That's the message all the 12 people brought. All the spies brought. It's a good land. Verse 26, we see the same difference. Notwithstanding, you would not go up, but rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God. Verse 27, and you murmured in your tents and said, because the Lord hated us, he hath brought us forth out of the land of Egypt to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us. See, very skillfully, these spies, other than Joshua and Caleb, they spread a rumor also. They said, it's a good land, a land that flows with milk and honey. God will give us the land. But nevertheless, we saw giants there. We saw the Amalekites there. There we saw the military, well-trained military people there. We saw fortified cities there. They are like giants. We are like grasshoppers in their sight. Not only in their sight, even also in our sight, we were like grasshoppers. They said it was a good land. And also they said, we are like grasshoppers. They are giants. They are walled cities, fortified cities. This also they spread. So in their tents, not publicly, in their tents, they were murmuring, the Lord has brought us out of Egypt only to deliver us to the Amalekites. How are we going to fight against these Amalekites? How is it possible? We were like grasshoppers before them. They all are trained military people. We were slaves all these years. We don't have weapons they got. They got chariots, they got horses, they got elephants. And we don't have any of those weapons. We can't fight against them. They're just sitting and talking in their house. They're sitting and talking in their tents. Please listen carefully. Not even talking, murmuring. I don't know how we are going to. We are going to only die. We cannot fight against them. What those 12 people say, it's a good land. And also 10 of them said, we saw giants there, we saw Amalekites there, we are like grasshoppers, etc., 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 which made the hearts of the people melt away. So they are sitting and murmuring in their houses. I don't have time to read all the passages. 28. They say, whither shall we go? Now we are in the wilderness. We cannot go to the left, nor to the right. Whither shall we go up? Our brethren have discouraged our hearts, saying, the people is greater and taller than we. The cities are great and walled up to heaven. And moreover, we have seen the sons of the Amalekites there, etc., etc. Go to verse 34. Go to verse 34. And the Lord heard the voice of your words. And the Lord heard the voice of your words. Who are talking? Husband and wife. Brothers, family members, parents and children. Talking where? In their tents. How are they talking? Just murmuring. Just murmuring. Where? In their tents. Who? family members, murmuring. In the name of Jesus, I tell you, the Lord heard the words of your voice. Last night, what husband and wife you talked. Last week, what parents and children you talked. What you murmured. What you chirped. In your houses, the Lord God heard the voice of your words. It's not in a public meeting. Because your hearts are melted. Because they are unable to exercise faith. You spoke something, you talked something. The Lord heard that. And the Lord says, and the Lord was wroth and swore, saying, you will not enter into the promised land. All those who murmured in their tents, all those who murmured in your houses, you will not enter the promised land. Today, if the Lord permit, those who murmured, those who spoke against God, those who spoke the words of unbelief, if the Lord will allow these people enter into heaven, then those Israelites who died in the wilderness, they will question God. God, you are very partial. You are very partial. You redeemed us by the blood of the Passover lamb. You brought us through the Red Sea. You led us through the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud. You fed us with manna our forefathers knew not. But because something we talked in our house, you didn't allow us to inherit the land of Cana. You didn't allow us to inherit the land of Cana. Now, Lord, how partial you are. You are allowing these people to heaven? Are you a true God with no partiality? They will question God. The only one thing, if you hear His voice today, harden not your hearts. Ask God to forgive you. Forgive a trespass. Ignorance has never been an excuse. In any law. In any law. Ignorance is not an excuse. The Lord said, none of you shall inherit Canaan. So all those who murmured against God, you will never inherit heaven. If the Lord could forgive you, again cleanse you by the blood of Jesus Christ, unless you got that rectified, you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So we have to be very careful about our talking. It's very costly. It will decide whether you'll inherit the kingdom of God or not. Your talk will decide whether you go to heaven or not. Your talks are very, very important. My dear brother, my dear sister, in Malachi chapter 3, verse 13 to 16, from 13 to 16, your words have been stout against me, the Lord says. Your words are very arrogant against me. Brother, sister, the Lord says, your words are very stout, very arrogant against me, saith the Lord. Yet you say, what we spoken so much against thee, what's that? What's that, Lord, I spoke so arrogantly against thee? Have you spoken anything arrogant against the Lord? Have you shown any arrogance against the Lord? Oh, no, I haven't shown any arrogance against. Nothing was so stout. Stout means moratitam. Nothing I have spoken. I have never spoken against. What's that I have spoken against the Lord? The Lord says, The Lord says, Yah have said, it is vain to serve God. At one point of time you said, no use in serving God. Serving God is not a full time. At one point of time you said, no use in sweeping the floor. No use in teaching the Sunday school. No use being in the choir. No use in spreading the chair. No use in helping the pastor. One, it's vain to serve the Lord. No use doing taking Sunday school. No use coming to VBS. You said it is arrogance against the Lord, the Lord says. The Lord says arrogant against the Lord. You are not speaking against the man. You are not speaking against the institution. You are not speaking against the high priest. What is serving the Lord in that time? It's not preaching. It's not prophesying. What is serving the Lord? Maybe opening the gate of the temple. What is serving the Lord? Maybe helping the priest in cutting the sacrifices. What is serving the Lord? Maybe taking the dung and the other waste to outside the camp. What is serving the Lord? Maybe making the bread. What is serving the Lord? Maybe that candle, trimming the twigs of the wicks of the candlelight. What is serving the Lord? What is serving the Lord? You said that's vain. It is arrogance against the Lord. You are speaking against the Lord. The Bible says, you have said, it is vain to serve God. Number two, and what profit is it that we have kept His ordinance? What profit? What's the profit? I am obeying God. I take a baptism. I remove jewels. And I come to, I pay my tithes. What it profits me? What's the, after all, by keeping the ordinances, what profit I get? Everything you calculate on profit. I put 2 rupees, so I must get 10-fold, or 100-fold, or 1,000-fold. You're calculating only on profit. You said, what profit in keeping God's commandments? It is arrogance against God. You spoke stout against God. The arrogant words, God says. You say, what's it I have spoken against God? What's the arrogance in God? You said, what's the use of serving Him? You asked a question, what profit you get because keeping the ordinances? Number three, it's very powerful. It's very powerful. And you said that we have walked mournfully before the Lord of hosts. What is that use of fasting? What is the use of having a holy look? What is the use of all this? Keeping the worldliness away. We cannot have a jolly birthday. We could not have jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells, dingle dingle Christmas. Very mournful. What is the use of this? See the Midianites. See the Egyptians. What are their festivals? Dancing. One day free. No husband, no wife, anybody can live with anybody. They can consume liquor. Consuming liquor is a worship to their liquor god. It's a worship to their liquor god. They can wear new dress, they can go to cinema, they can go for death. See how they celebrate their festivals. What is the use of this mournful Christianity? I can't enjoy the world. I can't enjoy the worldliness. I can't have the lusts of the world. I can't have my child's birthday as the world would have its birthday. I cannot celebrate festivals as the world would celebrate festivals. Oh, this pastor cutting the cake, he says something. Or this dress, he says something. Christmas tree, he says something. Why should I walk mournfully? What's the use of all these things? The Bible says, you are talking arrogant against God. Your words are stout against God. We have to be extremely careful about what we talk. I got 20 points to share. Please listen. It's only a prelude to those 20 points. What is the other thing? Talking stout against God. And now we call the proud happy. Number four, in talking stout against God, the worldly people, they are proud of their lifestyle. They got a car, they got estate, they got two houses, they bought a villa. They have worldly success and you are calling them happy. அவங்களாம் நல்லா இருக்காங்க. நம்ம ஏசு ஏசும் சொல்கிறோம், எனக்கு அரடி நிலம் கிடையாது, எனக்குன்னு சொந்தமாக அரடி நிலம் கிடையாது. ஊழியன் வந்தாங்க, நிறையா வீடெல்லாம் கட்டியிருக்கிறாங்க. நான் பைத்தியார்த்தனமா நானும் கடவுள் கடவுள்னு இருந்துட்டேன். அவங்கெல்லாம் எவ்வளோ சந்தோஷம் ஜாலியாக இருக்காங்க. இட் இஸ் எ அரகன்ஸ் அகேன்ஸ்ட் காட் டு சே லைக் தட், டு கால் த ப்ரவுட் ஹாப்பி. Literally, to call the worldly successful happy. If you say they are happy, who is happy? They that mourn, blessed are they that mourn. Not blessed they that have estate. Not blessed they that have cars. Not blessed they that got houses untold, wealth untold. Blessed are they that mourn. Blessed are they that poor in the spirit. When you say the proud are happy, you are arrogance against God. You are speaking stout against God. You are speaking stout against God. And now we call the proud happy. Yeah, they that work wickedness are set up. You say, only those who are doing wickedness, they are elevated. Napa walagatla, nimma kada mela mela poite irukran. If you open your mouth and say, only the wicked are successful, they are set up, they are elevated, it's a sin. Even if you open your mouth and say, pa ella dunmarka da pa nalla irukran, avan nalla illa, dunmarka nalla illa, because he has got a higher chair, don't think that nalla irukan. Because Lazarus was not a beggar, don't say begging is poor. We must have a spiritual perception. The moment you say the proud are happy, the moment you say the wicked are successful, your words are arrogant against God. I do believe that none of us can escape these arrogant words we have spoken against God, not knowing that these words are stout against God. But the Bible is very clear. Your words are stout against God. And next one, your arrogance against God. Yea, they that tempt God are even delivered. Those who don't believe God, what God can do. I'll do like this. I'll go before, let God come behind me. God will do what I want. What God can do? If I write, if I say speak a lie, will God put me in hell? What God can do? Let me see whether God throws me to hell or not. They tempt God. And those who tempt God, you say they are delivered. I am not delivered. Only they are delivered. They are tempting God. They are questioning God. They are not believing God. They are delivered. They get emotional. They are successful. Whenever you see these words, whenever you speak these words, what are the words you speak? Maybe knowingly or unknowingly, you speak these words and you say that it's vain to serve God, or you say what is profit to keep His ordinance, or you say that what is the use of just not enjoying the world, or you say the wicked people are there happy, or you say that the wicked people, they are successful, they are set up, they go to higher strata of society, or you say those who tempt God, those who challenge God, or rather those who challenge God, they are delivered. When you say all these things, you are stout against God, you are arrogant against God. And the Lord says, verse 16, then they that fear the Lord spake often one to another. Who said all these things? Who said all these things? They that fear the Lord. Children of God. There he talks about the Jewish people. Malachi was writing to the Jewish people. Those who come back from the Babylonian captivity. I'm sorry. Assyrian captivity. They come back from the Assyrian captivity. or the Babylonian captivity rather. They come back from the Babylonian captivity. They speak. The Lord said, they that fear the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before him for them that fear the Lord, and that thought upon his name. Everything the Lord records. Everything the Lord records. Is there, what's the use of serving the Lord? What's the use of in the Sunday school? What's the use of in the choir? Or what's the use of spreading the church? What's the use of in media? Or what's the use of preaching? What's the use of coming to the ministry? What's the use of walking mournfully? What's this, this, this? Only the wicked people are successful, etc., etc., etc. Everything he has recorded, sister. Brother, everything he has recorded. Everything he has recorded. That's why in Matthew chapter 12 verse 36, I do believe I'm making a note of all these verses. Matthew chapter 12 36, but I say unto you that every idle word, useless word, unprofitable word, that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. If you want to believe Jesus, believe him. If you don't want to believe Jesus, don't believe him. Jesus said, for every idle word you speak, every idle word you speak, you have to give an account. In many translations, this idle word, word that cannot bring profit, words that will have a wrong end, words of no use, you have to give an account. You have to give an account. From the time that you know to speak, what all you have spoken, it is recorded. If it is idle, unprofitable, vain babblings, stout words against God, words of unbelief, you have to give an account. I just say 20 things. You can just make a note of it. I say that in Tamil and English so that it could reach you. Number one, Seer Gedana Pech. Profane, worthless, base, in right Tamil, Kiltharamana Pech. Seer, endal seer, seer verse says, seer mihu. Seer kedakudiya pech. Only seer kedakudiya pech. Number two, Kilavihan Pech. Old wives' fable. What is old wives' fable? Summa ukandha vetti pech, silly talk. Onnu adhula periya matter la irukadhu, kan blah 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 blah, vetti pech. I'm saying this Tamil so that you can correctly understand. Number three, veen pech, vain babbling. After all, what's the benefit? Enna pesiten onnu pesala, ey ivula neram pesiten ningala enna pesiten ninga onnu pesala, ey pesiten thanada irundinga. சும்மா பேசிக்கிட்டு இருந்தோம். சும்மா என்னடா பேசுனீங்க? ஒன்றும் பேசலப்பா. இங்க ஒன்றும் பேசாம இவ்வளவு நேரம் பேசியிருக்கான். அத்தனை வார்த்தைக்கு நீ கணக்கு கொடுக்க போற. வெயின் நம்பர் ஃபோர், பிளீஸ் மேக் அ நோட் ஆஃப் இட். புத்தியீனமான பேச்சு, ஃபூலிஷ் டாக். ஃபூலிஷ், யோசிக்காம பேசிட்டேன், புத்தி இல்லாம பேசிட்டேன், விளையாட்டுக்கு சொல்லிட்டேன், ஃபூலிஷ் டாக். நம்பர் ஃபைவ், அயுக்தமான தர்க்கங்கள். அயுக்தம், தி தமிழ் வேர்ட் இஸ் நாட் பாப்புலர். ஐ வாஸ் ஆஸ்கிங் சிஸ்டர் தி அதர் டே, வாட் இஸ் அயுக்தம்? யுக்தி, ஸ்கில்ஃபுல். யுக்தி, அயுக்தி ஆப்போசிட் டு ஸ்கில்ஃபுல், அன்ஸ்கில்ஃபுல். அயுக்தம் மீன்ஸ் சென்ஸ்லெஸ், ஸ்கில்லெஸ். யோசிக்காம பேசுறதுன்னு வச்சுக்கோங்களேன், ரொம்ப ஸ்கில்ஃபுல்லா பேசுறது. அயுக்தமான தர்க்கங்கள், யுக்தி மீன்ஸ் யூ நோ ஸ்கில்ஃபுல். நம்பர் சிக்ஸ், மேக் அ நோட் குயிக்லி, வம்பு பேச்சு, ஃபில்தி, இன்டீசன், டபுள் மீனிங் கமெண்ட்ஸ், டபுள் மீனிங் கமெண்ட்ஸ், டர்ட்டி கமெண்ட்ஸ், Even some preachers use this type of dirty comments from the pulpit. Indecent talks. Number 7. Pariyasa pech. Jestings. Foolish jokings. For some people it's only giggling. What's there for giggling? They don't know. Anything, everything. We are saints. We are called to be saints. We are called to be saints. In our native place, they have one phrase. Walapai. They use only walapai. Walapai. Dog was doing some dirty thing. Sounds. Walapai la zanja mari. No. Walapai la zanja mari paisi. Nai zanja mari paisi. There. Justly. Number 8. Pollada katta vaarthe evil. Evil. What is that evil? I wanted to know the meaning. It's words that could hurt others, that could insult others. Very hard. Kadina vaarthe. Katta vaarthe. Words that could hurt others. They are evil words. We have to be very careful about it. Number 9. Kabada pech. Keeping something inside. Speaking something outside. Oh, praise Lord, Pastor. Praise Lord, Sister. Something inside. But a deception. A deception. In the house, the wife would be talking about an auntie. Yo, that auntie, I don't want to see her. She was such a horrible woman. If I see her, I would run away from her. When she was talking about that auntie, bell rang. She opened the door. That auntie is there. This lady said the truth. Said the truth. What truth? Auntie, vangala patta pesitu na vanga vanga auntie. True. But not pure truth. அவங்கள பத்தி தான் பேசிக்கிட்டு இருந்தாங்க. ஆனா இந்த 32 பல்லு இழிக்கிற மாதிரி பேசுறது. யோ ஆண்டி அருவர், ஐ கான்ட் டாலரேட் ஹர். வென் யூ சீ தட் ஆண்டி, ஆண்டி வாங்க வாங்க, ஐயோ உங்களை பத்தி தான் பேச, கரெக்டா வந்துட்டீங்க ஆண்டி, உங்களுக்கு 100 ஆயுசு. அடப்பாவி, உனக்காகவே ஆண்டவர் நரகத்தை வச்சிருக்கடியில் நம்ம எங்க கொண்டு போடுறது, பல்லவத்துக்கு கொண்டு போக முடியாது. இந்த கபடஸ்தரெல்லாம் பல்லவத்துக்கு கொண்டு போக முடியாது. நல்ல கடவுள். இந்த பிசாசு மக்களுக்காகவே நரகத்தை வச்சிருக்கு. பிசாசு மக்கள் அவன் பொய்யனும் பொய்க்கு பிதாவும் அப்படி அவன் ஆக்ட் பண்ணிடுவான். ஐயோ உங்களை பத்தான ஹேட் டு பி வெரி கேர்ஃபுல் அபவுட் தி ஹேட் டு கிவ் அக்கவுண்ட் ஃபார் ஆல் தீஸ் திங்ஸ். தென் தி நம்பர் 10 கட்டுக்கதைகள். இட்ஸ் நாட் ஜஸ்ட் சேயிங் அ ஸ்டோரி ஃபார் த மாரல், பட் லிட்ரலி ஸ்பீக்கிங் சம்திங் யூ கேன் ஸ்பின் அண்ட் சே. நீயா கூட்டி கட்டி சேர்த்து கதை பேசுறது. நம்பர் 11 வாக்குவாதம், கண்டென்ஷன்ஸ், ஆர்கியூ ஃபார் எனி திங் யூ சே தே வில் ஆர்கியூ. நம்பர் 13, நம்பர் 12 சண்டையை பிறப்பிக்கும் தர்க்கங்கள், த சிஸ்டர் ஆஃப் ஆர்கியூமெண்ட்ஸ், ஆர்கியூமெண்ட் தட் கேன் பிகெட் ஸ்ட்ரைப்ஸ், யூ மஸ்ட் நோட் டு ஸ்டாப் இட். நம்பர் 13 ஞானம் என்று பொய்யாய் பெயர் பெற்றிருக்கிற கொள்கை விபரீதம், திங்கிங் தட் யூ ஆர் ஸ்மார்ட் அண்ட் ஆர்கியூவிங், திங்கிங் தட் யூ ஆர் ஸ்மார்ட் அண்ட் ஆர்கியூவிங். Number 14, this Maimala page. It is something closer to the Kabadam. And number 15, lies, Poi page. Kabadam, Maimalam, Poi. I don't have time to explain the differences, almost one and the same. Backbiting, Purangurdu. Backbiting. 17, proud. God is against the proud speech. Number 18, avabhakti, that can bring ungodliness. The talk that can bring ungodliness. Number 19, avviswasa, talk that bring unbelief. Talk that bring unbelief. And number 20, devanukku virodhama, against God. Against God's things, against God's ordinances, against God's ministry, against God's servant of God. Anything that you speak is all unprofitable. Today decide that you will run away from these vain babblings. You will be brought to God's judgment, not because you have murdered, not because you have robbed, not because you committed adultery, not because you raped somebody, but you will be brought to judgment because of the words you have spoken. Because of the words you have spoken. About every word you talk. Vain word. Vain word. My dear brother, I said it's a message to me. I remember my early days when I counted how many words I have spoken in a day. I don't say that I can escape. And depending on the grace of God, he that is holy, let him be holy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. He that is unholy, let him be unholy still. The Spirit of the Lord has spoken to you. So escape from Sodom and escape to the mountain I show. Speak words that could profit others. Speak words of grace. In the lips of the bride, there was honey. Under her tongue, there's honey and milk. It doesn't say you should be dumb. Speak. Speak words of energy. Speak words that can build others. Speak words that can profit others. Anything that you speak which doesn't profit others is a ketavarta. Anything that cannot build others, exhort others, strengthen others, words of faith, not words that could melt others' heart. Words that could bring profit to others, words that can lead them to heaven. Escape from Sodom. Escape to the mountain God shows. If the Bible doesn't say tie a towel around your lips, or the Bible doesn't say put a zip on your lips, talk in season and out of season, talk words of encouragement, talk words of heaven, talk words of power, talk words of energy, talk words that can bring faith, talk words that can build family, talk words that could strengthen people. You have to talk. I am unable to stop. Start. I don't say after the service you should not talk to anybody. But if you talk vain talks, if you talk nonsense, if you talk rubbish, just jestlings, just a humor, you are going to be judged. Otherwise Jesus is a liar. Jesus said, every vain word that you talk, you have to give an account on the day of judgment. I don't say put a hanky around your lips and go. I tell you, talk. Talk words of wisdom. You just, God willing, I'll take the topic again. You go home and read Proverbs chapter 10. How you should talk. The whole chapter, Proverbs 10. Your tongue, your lips, the mouth. How the talk of a righteous man, the wise man. My dear brother, my dear sister, இனிய உளவாக எண்ணாது கூறல் கனி இருப்ப காய் கவர்ந்துட்டு இனிய உளவாக. There are words, good words. Words like honey. Honey that's from honeycomb. Words that can encourage, words that can build others. இனிய உளவாக. Why you talk இன்னாது? Useless, unprofitable, hurting, insulting, humiliating, joking, jostling. இனிய உளவாக இன்னாது கூறல் கனி இருப்ப காய் கவர்ந்தட்டு. In all this message, I didn't say escape from Sodom. I want to tell you, escape to the mountain I show. Shall we pray? He that has got an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord says to the church.